W.F. House presents an unabridged recording of The Lost Diaries of Adrian Mole, 1999 to 2001, by Sue Townsend. Narrated by Mathew Horne.
Foreword. These diaries were lost when I moved from my modest council estate home back to my parents' equally modest home in Ashby de la Zouche. After the events of Saturday 24th of November 2001, when I was dragged out of my bed at 4 a.m. by an overenthusiastic policeman citing David Blunkett's anti-terrorism laws, I could no longer return home. My neighbours informed me that after I had been taken away to be questioned, people in white forensic suits took away every piece of paper in large sacks. Every floorboard was pulled up, plaster was taken off the walls, and the garden was dug and soil removed for examination. After my release, I asked for my 1999 to 2001 diaries, but was told that the police were hanging on to them should any charges be brought against me, Mohammed, and his brother Imran. Then, last week, I answered the door of the renovated pigsty where I now live to find a policeman holding my diaries, which were inside a transparent plastic bag. He said, "I think these belong to you, sir." I examined them and said, not without a hint of sarcasm, "So I'm no longer under suspicion, am I? I'm not going to be snatched from my bed and flown on a rendition flight to be waterboarded in Turkey, then?" The policeman said, extremely sarcastically, "Oh, did we forget to tell you that you'd been cleared, sir? I do hope you haven't been tossing and turning in your bed at night, sir. We were closing the old police station down and we found these in the evidence store." He handed the bag over to me. I said a curt thank you and closed the door on him. On rereading my diary entries, I am struck by the melancholy tone of the majority of them. I do not seem to be able to find lasting love, and my writing career remains but a dream. I am now living with my wife, Daisy, and my 4-year-old daughter, Gracie, in the aforementioned pigsty in a village called Mangold Parva in the Leicestershire countryside. I wish that I could relate that I have found happiness and contentment in my rural retreat, but, alas, I cannot. But that is another story. I remain, dear reader, your most humble and obedient servant, Adrian Albert Mole. P.S. These diary entries have appeared in The Guardian previously, having been hijacked by a woman fraudster called Sue Townsend. She has made quite a lucrative living passing herself off as me. I know where she lives. I have been to her house and rung her doorbell, but she refuses to come to the door. Once I saw her through the front window. She was a large shape sitting in the corner of a gloomy room swigging from what looked like a bottle of Stolichnaya. Her garden is overgrown, and her house is in disrepair. She has obviously fallen on bad times. I can't say I'm sorry. She has been a parasite on my literary career for too long. 1999. Friday, November 26, 1999. 2:30 p.m. Wisteria Walk, Ashby de la Zouche, Leicestershire. I have not kept a diary since the fire destroyed my house, furniture, clothes, books, and life savings. The arsonist, Eleanor Flood, is residing in a secure unit, where she is doing an MA. Her dissertation is entitled The Phoenix, Myth or Metaphor? I know, because she writes to me occasionally. I have protested to the authorities, but they are powerless to stop her letters, which are obviously being smuggled out by a corrupt prison guard. As I lie in bed at night, listening to the breathing of my sons, William, 7, and Glenn, 13, in their bunk beds only inches away from my head, I often think of Eleanor Flood and envy her. At least she has a room of her own, and time in which to think and write. 11 p.m. Took the boys to watch Santa abseiling down the side of Debenhams in Leicester tonight on his way to his grotto. William was enchanted by the sight of Santa swinging from a climbing rope, but Glenn kept looking around anxiously at the crowd of onlookers. He said, "If anybody from school sees me here, I'm a dead man, Dad." The queue for the grotto was at least 70 deep. It snaked through toys into bed linens and small electrical appliances. To placaters, Debenhams played Sir Cliff Richard's rendition of the Lord's Prayer, sung to the tune of Auld Lang Syne. An old man with his great-granddaughter muttered, I didn't fight in two world wars so that Cliff Richard could line his pockets by exploiting the Lord's Prayer. A Scotsman behind him said, "Aye, and the bastards murdering Auld Lang Syne." I left the boys in the queue and went to Boots to buy some Nurofen and a packet of Starburst. I am mildly addicted to both. As I walked through the Fox Hunter shopping centre, I passed a fat elf smoking a cigarette. I approached the elf and said, "Forgive me, but are you one of Santa's little helpers?" He scowled and said, "I'm on a break. What do you want?" I explained about the queue in Debenhams and asked for his help, citing Glenn's attention deficit disorder. On our way back to the queue, the fat elf explained that he'd just been sacked from his job as an undermanager at NatWest. He said elf work was harder than it looked. Cheeriness didn't come easily to him. I sympathised. "Perhaps we could meet up for a drink one night," he said. I looked at his weak eyes and his beer gut spilling over his green tights and gave him a false telephone number. The fat elf took us to the front of the queue by saying, make way for this tragic family." The queue parted with much speculation as to which of the three of us was terminally ill. Santa was a disgrace. His beard was hanging off, and he'd made no attempt to hide his Reebok trainers. However, William was sufficiently deceived and asked for a Barbie hairdressing salon. Saturday, November 27th. Wisteria Walk, Ashby de la Zouche, Leicestershire. My mother married for the fourth time today. She is on the way to being the Elizabeth Taylor of Ashby de la Zouche. Unfortunately, her bridegroom, Ivan Braithwaite, had been encouraged by his night school creative writing teacher to write a Millennium marriage service. I had to look away when he turned to my mother and vowed, "Pauline, my soon-to-be wife, I swear to love you emotionally, spiritually, and physically forever, plus one more day." When my mother replied, "Ivan, my soon-to-be husband, I swear to be supportive of your life choices, aware of your hidden vulnerability, and fully cognizant of your sexual needs." I almost ran from the registrar's office. My mother didn't actually say, "I do," because she got a rogue hat feather stuck down her throat and had a choking fit. Does this make the marriage invalid? I hope so. 2 a.m. Work on my serial killer comedy for the BBC, The White Van. It's coming along nicely. Wednesday, December 1st. Wisteria Walk, Ashby de la Zouche, Leicestershire. I found a tin of Whopper hot dogs in my mother's bed this morning. It was a disturbing image, reminding me somehow of my one and only visit to Amsterdam. I was intending to wash her bed linen as a surprise for when she returned from her honeymoon in Pompeii. But in the circumstances, I simply pulled the duvet straight and plumped up the pillows. Thursday, December 2nd. After waiting 3 weeks, I finally got to see the new GP, Dr. Eng. I asked him if he was related to the Dr. Eng in Soho, whom I occasionally consulted. He said no. I said I was surprised, as Eng was an unusual name. For some reason, he took offence at this and snapped, "There are millions of Engs in the world." I sensed that I had committed a faux pas and changed the subject to that of my health. I explained that for some 5 years I have needed to consume at least 5 packets of opal fruits a day. He furrowed his brow. "Opal fruits," he checked. "They've since changed the name to Starburst," I said, unable to keep the bitterness out of my voice. I told him about the panic attack I had recently when I discovered there were no opal fruits in the house, of how I had walked to the BP garage in the rain at 3 a.m. to buy some. "Do you have any advice?" I asked. "Yes," he said, turning to his computer, where my records were displayed. "Buy them wholesale." I had booked a double appointment, so I took my time while I filled him in about my latest phobia, falling in the crater of a live volcano. "Should I seek help?" "No," said Dr. Eng. "You should keep away from volcanoes." For the first time in my adult life, I left the surgery without a prescription. On my way out, I asked Mrs. Gringle, the receptionist, what the yellow sticker on the front of my medical records denoted. "Time waster," she said coldly. She has never liked our family since my mother called the doctor out on Christmas Day after my father swigged a decanter full of Stolichnaya vodka, believing it to be Malvern water. Friday, December 3rd. An awkward moment at breakfast. Glenn said, I reckon you should tell William the truth about Father Christmas, Dad. Apparently, William has worked out on the computer at nursery school that it would take Father Christmas 15 trillion hours to visit every child in the world. Should I continue the charade that the toys are made in Greenland by elves, or should I confess that the plastic rubbish he craves is shipped from Taiwan, then brought to Toys R Us by container lorry? Saturday, December 4th. William is confused about the Blair baby. He's got it into his head, from watching the news on TV, that it will be the new Messiah. How Glenn and I laughed. Though when I asked Glenn what he knew about the Messiah, it turned out that he'd never heard of him. I was just laughing to keep you company, he said. Sunday, December 5th. Went to the lawns for tea today with my father and his newish wife, Tanya. To my joy, Pandora was there, looking ravishing in pink cashmere. I told her that I had overheard complaints in the post office that she was neglecting her constituents. I'm talking to you, aren't I? She said angrily. I took this opportunity to ask for her help with jumping the council house queue. She said, are you mad? I couldn't possibly be seen to be helping my half-brother. She pressed speed dial on her mobile and left a message. Ken, darling, Dobbo's camper telling the press you've got a fatal fungal infection from the newts. She dialed again. Dobbo, darling, Ken's people are telling the press you've been seen in B&Q buying a noose. She always was a stirrer. Tuesday, December 7th. Wisteria Walk, Ashby de la Zouche, Leicestershire. My mother returned from her honeymoon tonight. She complained about the cold weather in Pompeii and talked about suing cheapo tours. She has already filled in one of their official complaint forms with the lie that she was forced to buy a cashmere sweater, pashmina shawl, and a Gucci leather jacket in an attempt to keep warm. When I pointed out to her that it was ludicrous to have expected blue skies and hot sun in December, she said that she was led to believe that Vesuvius would give off some residual heat. By whom? I asked. A geologist I met on the net, she replied. I advised her to drop her claim. Wednesday, December 8th. William has changed his mind about the Barbie hairdressing salon. He is now demanding the same present that Brooklyn Beckham is getting, a £45,000 toy Ferrari from Harrods. I admit to feeling bitter and resentful about this. Beckham Jr. is 9 months old and has never done a stroke of work in his life, yet he'll soon be driving around in the lap of luxury, whereas I'm an involuntary pedestrian. Where is the justice in that? Thursday, December 9th. Job Centre New Deal Appointment, 10:15. Catherine Root is my personal job advisor. She is personable enough, though somebody should tell her that it is possible to cure a squint these days. Ms. Root wrote down my work experience and qualifications. Librarian, civil servant with responsibility for newt and natterjack toad statistics, offal chef and TV presenter. Quite an eclectic mix, I said, anxious to impress on her that I was not just any old job seeker, but had an extensive vocabulary and would be wasted sweeping leaves in the grounds of an institution. Do you have a degree? She inquired, almost looking me in the eye. No, I admitted, but I did once share a flat in Oxford with Dr. Pandora Braithwaite, MP. This was a mistake. Ms. Root turned out to be a critic of Pandora's, remarking coldly that, in her opinion, she had lost touch with her constituents. When I asked for proof of this, Ms. Root said Pandora had turned down a request to open the job centre's new toilet block, disappointing many. I left with an appointment to see a Mr. Nobby Brown of Brown's Poultry at 11 a.m. tomorrow. Friday, December 10th. I am now employed as a turkey plucker. For £3.50 an hour, I pull the feathers out of recently deceased birds. I work with 6 women in an ill-lit shed. The noise and cackling is indescribable, and the turkeys being butchered next door kick up their own hideous din too. 11 p.m. Went to Glenn's school tonight to see their Christmas musical, Jesus in Las Vegas, A Star is Born, written by Roger Patience, the headmaster. Glenn played a croupier who helped at the birth. Some of the audience were obviously taken aback when Mary made her entrance in a strapless sequined evening dress to be joined by Joseph in his tuxedo singing All Shook Up. But I took it in my stride. I am conversant with avant-garde theatre. I have been to the Royal Court Theatre in London several times. Sunday, December 12th. I asked Costas in the kebab shop why he was in such a bad mood tonight. "It's that bloody Tony Blair," he said, hacking angrily at the doner turning on the spit. "He broke his bloody promise, innit?" "On what?" I asked. "On a bloody Elgin Marbles, innit?" he snarled. I mentioned to him that Turkey was about to join the EU, but not until I was leaving and was safely through the door. Friday, December 24th. Wisteria Walk, Ashby de la Zouche, Leicestershire. I thank God that my work at Brown's Poultry is seasonal and therefore over. I managed to keep my turkey-plucking job a secret from my family, though tonight my mother asked me why I had feathers in my hair. I made up the ludicrous story that a pillow had burst as I walked through Debenham's bedding department while Christmas shopping. She narrowed her eyes and was about to speak when Ivan called from the kitchen that the sellotape had run out. This led to a row, with various members of the family accusing the others of wasting, hogging, or using too much sellotape while wrapping presents. Being the only one sober, I was forced to drive to the BP garage. The shelves were empty of stationery goods, but my friend Mohammed, the manager, took pity on me and gave me some sticky tape from the back office. It was an act of Christian charity. Later, I was blowing the feathers out of my underpants with a hairdryer when my mother barged into my room. She said, "If you're going to indulge in bizarre sexual practices, you should put a bolt on that door." Christmas Day. William quickly tired of his main present, the Barbie hair salon. The rollers were fiddly and Barbie kept slipping out of the chair until I fastened her in with a lump of blue tack. My father arrived at 11 and sneered when he saw William brushing the doll's tresses with a tiny plastic brush. "He'll end up a bleeding pufter," he laughed, before thrusting an ill-wrapped present into William's arms. It was an action man riding a motorbike armed with a rocket launcher and enough ammunition to annihilate China. I said, I specifically requested that William was not to be given any gender-targeted toys. Later, I watched in disgust as my little son made Action Man rampage through the hair salon, kidnap Barbie, and subject her to various indignities. Boxing Day. The Moles took tea with the Braithwaites today. The atmosphere was strained to start with and was made much worse when my mother ridiculed the dome, saying it looked like a female porcupine about to mate. Pandora snapped that she had been invited to Millennium Eve in the dome. I asked to see her ticket. She said it was in the post. Friday, December 31st, 1999. I borrowed my mother's car and spent the evening driving Glenn and William around Leicestershire in a fruitless search for beacons and fireworks. Eventually, in Victoria Park, we came across a brazier on a pole fueled by a cylinder of British gas. A kindly Hindu man handed out samosas to the few spectators. When the town hall clock began to sound the hour, we celebrated the new year by sharing a bottle of Morrison's Bucks Fizz with a party of drag queens, dressed as Sleeping Beauty, Cinderella, Snow White, etc. William asked to be introduced to the beautiful princesses. He didn't appear to notice that most of them had severe 5 o'clock shadow. When the clock struck 12, I kissed my boys. Then we linked arms with strangers and attempted to sing Auld Lang Syne. Some rowdy elements in the crowd sang the tune but improvised the words, bellowing scurrilous and defamatory things about Sir Cliff Richard. Later, at home, we watched as a family as the guests inside the dome crisscrossed arms. Glenn said, "How come the Queen don't know how to do Auld Lang Syne proper, Dad?" For once, I didn't correct his appalling grammar, though I have resolved to do so in the year 2000. As I went upstairs to bed, Ivan drunkenly whispered, "Your mother told me about your feather fixation. Do you want to talk about it?" I resolved at that moment to move into 7 Scrag Close, the council house I previously, arrogantly, stupidly turned down. 2000. Monday, January 3rd, 2000. Wisteria Walk, Ashby de la Zouche, Leicestershire. So, how do I greet the new millennium? In despair. I'm a single parent, I live with my mother, my novels remain unpublished. My cookery book, Awfully Good, is to be found in all bad bookshops at 59p a copy. I have a bald patch the size of a jaffa cake on the back of my head. Nobody's face lights up when I enter a room. My sons would probably miss me if I ran away, but it might take them a week or two to notice that I was gone. How did it come to this? I showed such promise when I was a youth. Why haven't I received my fair share of the glittering prizes? My TV celebrity in 1997 was short-lived. And anyway, who wants to be famous for cooking offal on cable television? It's time for a total re-evaluation. I must reinvent myself. I can't go on like this, drifting into early middle age. I need a life plan, and one that includes my two sons. Tuesday, January 4th. This morning I decided to involve my sons in formulating my life plan. I went into their bedroom and switched off the TV and removed the videotape they'd been laughing at. Footage recorded from Sky News of Pandora Braithwaite and her fellow VIPs shivering in the queue in a stiff breeze at Stratford Railway Station. They protested, but I said, "We moles must grab the new millennium by its throat, shake it about, and force it to work for us." I gave them a pen and paper and asked them to write down their goals in life. William wrote, "More sweets, my own telly, get an Andrex dog." Glenn wrote, "I should like to get married when I am 18, as I think it is a good way to get sex without going out every night. To be the runner-up to the world champion rollerblader would be quiet, sick, nice." I challenged Glenn with this. "Why only runner-up? Why not go all out for world champion?" I asked. "Because I don't want to get too famous, Dad," he said. "That poor little Brooklyn's having to be guarded by the SAS now, ain't he?" My poor son is obsessed with the gormless Beckhams and their offspring. My own life goals are as follows. 1. Buy large detached house in respectable suburb. 2. Find soulmate with huge intellect, large earning power, and substantial breasts. 3. Insist on meeting with head of BBC Drama and refuse to leave his office until he has bought the white van, my comedy about a serial killer. 4. Have modest hair weave. Wednesday, January 5th. My mother and Ivan have been in bed all day with the Australian flu. I looked in on them tonight. My mother croaked, about bloody time, we're dying of neglect in here. I said I was respecting your privacy. She begged me to call out the emergency doctor, saying she felt desperately ill, but I refused, saying we mustn't put further pressures on the National Health Service. I mixed them each a blackcurrant lem sip and left them to sweat it out. As I closed their bedroom door, I heard Ivan wheeze. I've had more compassion from the Inland Revenue. I was awoken several times in the night by their annoying coughs and feeble cries for attention. Eventually, Ivan crawled downstairs and called the doctor, who sent for an ambulance. Thursday, January the 6th. My mother is now in hospital 60 miles away, where they are treating her pneumonia. I refuse to feel guilty. Guilt is a destructive emotion and doesn't fit in with my life plan. I completed yet another housing form in my attempt to get a decent council house. To gain a few more points, I ticked the gay box. The forms are totally confidential, so nobody outside the housing office will ever know that I am really a... Friday, January the 7th. Too ill with flu to write much. I pray for death. Ivan found the housing application form and said to me, "I always knew." Friday, January 28th. Wisteria Walk, Ashby de la Zouche, Leicestershire. The Sydney flu has swept through the Mole family like a viral hurricane and has left us traumatised and weakened. The bathroom cabinet cannot hold all the prescription drugs, so a pine shelf has been cleared of its bath oils and pressed into service. Each of us moles developed complications. Dr. Ng was at the house so often that I'm surprised he didn't bring his toiletry bag and slippers. One day, after being summoned urgently to my bedside, he rang the Lancet on his mobile and asked if they'd be interested in a 1,000-word article on GP rage. Saturday, January 29th. I received the following letter this morning. Dear Adrian, remember me? I am your mother, Pauline Mole, currently residing in Bed 5, Ward 20, Glengorse District Hospital. I am recovering from pneumonia and pleurisy and have been here for 3 long weeks, on oxygen. I am very hurt that you haven't been to see me, sent me flowers, or written a card. Your neglect is impeding my recovery. I can't sleep for wondering where I went wrong. Love from your mother. P.S. I have stopped smoking. It is too difficult to manage in an oxygen mask. Dear Mum, is it really 3 weeks? It has gone by in a flash. I'm pleased to hear that you have stopped smoking. I have collected up the ashtrays, all 31 of them, and thrown them into the wheelie bin so as to lessen the temptation when you get home. The reason I haven't visited you is because I am still weak from the Sydney flu. Dr. Ng was called to my bedside 4 times, twice in the middle of the night. You should count yourself lucky that you were given a hospital bed, even though it was 60 miles away. I intended to send you a bouquet of flowers, but, quite honestly, I was horrified at the prices they were asking. The minimum charge for a bouquet is £15. There is a delivery charge of £2.50. It is sheer exploitation. I concede that I could have sent you a get-well card, but a trip to the shops is out of the question until I regain the strength in my legs. Your husband, Ivan, has kept me informed about your progress. You have been in my thoughts, and I am hurt and annoyed to be charged with neglecting you. Your son, Adrian. I gave this note to Ivan to give to my mother. He is a fool for love. He drives 60 miles there and back a day to visit her. At 10 p.m, Ivan got back from the hospital. He was ecstatic. Your mother woke up this morning and asked for her makeup bag, he said. He confided in me that when she'd first been admitted, he passed her hospital bed twice without recognising her. He'd never seen her without lipstick or mascara before. He gave me a reply from my mother. Dear Adrian, so I'm not worth £17.50? When I think of the money and attention that I've lavished on you over 32 years, it makes me sick. I will probably be discharged in a couple of days. I want you gone from Wisteria Walk by then. You must take your boys and go and live with your father and Tanya. There are 4 empty bedrooms at the Lawns, formerly known as your mother. Sunday, January 30th. Just returned from the Lawns after explaining my housing dilemma to my father and his wife Tanya. They were not exactly keen to take me and my boys in. We use those bedrooms, said my father. I keep my golf clubs in one. And Tanya overwinters the geraniums in another. That still leaves 2 empty rooms, I pointed out. Sadly, no, said Tanya. I'm in the process of turning one of those rooms into a meditation space. And the last remaining room? I inquired with a cynical sneer. My father turned away, but Tanya stared me out. The 4th room is to be used to store my collection of Millennium Dome memorabilia, she said. As I stumbled away from the Lawns, I dashed tears from my eyes. All hope is gone. The council estate beckons. Monday, January 31st. The Lawns, Ashby de la Zouche, Leicestershire. After a dramatic late-night phone call from my father, me and my family have been granted temporary asylum, for 1 week only, at the above address. Me and my boys are sharing a room with 16 overwintering geraniums. I am sleeping on an inflatable mattress, purchased from the Innovations catalogue. The boys are on a double futon. I have always wondered who bought futons. Now I know. It is Tanya Braithwaite, my new stepmother, who loves everything Japanese. She recently renamed Henry, her Labrador puppy. He is now to be called Yoko. No wonder the creature looks confused. It won't be long before the house has to be given a new name. The Lawns have nearly all gone and have been replaced with gravel. Meaningful boulders and ponds full of koi carp. Them fish ain't shy, Dad, said Glenn this morning as we were passing a pond on the way to the car. So how come they're called koi? I was almost at school before I realised that Glenn had made a joke. Surely this facility with puns is a sign of my eldest son's intelligence. His teachers are obviously wrong in their assessment of him. He could be the Kathy Lett of the 2000s. I parked, as usual, on the zigzag lines outside the infant school's entrance and was astonished to be pounced on by the headmistress, Mrs. Portnoy. Mr. Mole, she said, I have repeatedly asked parents, both verbally and in writing, not to park on the zigzag lines. Why can't you walk William to school? I kissed William and pushed him into the playground before tackling Portnoy's complaint. Wednesday, February 2nd. Am I the only one to have noticed that today's date is 2-2-2000? Nobody else has remarked on it. I rang the housing department and, after explaining my dilemma, was put through to the homeless unit. I am suspicious of anything called a unit. It smacks of despair and hopelessness and a dislocation from normality. I made an appointment to meet my designated housing officer, a Ms. Pig. Why, oh why, don't these people with ludicrous names take advantage of our accessible deed poll laws? Thursday, February 3rd. Ms. Pig is a personable young woman, breasts like large Bramley cooking apples, legs hidden under long black skirt, first name Pamela. She was reading my application form when I entered her office. So, she said, after a brief but boring exchange about the weather, you are a gay single father of two boys. I bent down to pull up my socks. I needed time to think. Should I own up to my heterosexuality or carry on with the deception, thus earning me more housing points? Ms. Pig was looking at me sympathetically. I stroked my moustache. Ms. Pig said, "You're obviously not comfortable with your sexuality, Mr. Mole." I wondered what the penalty was for giving false information on an official council form. "No," I muttered. "Nobody must ever find out." Ms. Pig touched my hand. "Trust me," she said. "The moment passed when I could have come clean. There's a three-bedroom house with a garden on the Gateskell estate." "No," I interrupted, "not the Gateskell. It's populated with homophobes."
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.